is Eduroam. Eduroam, it's a worldwide network of Wi-Fi hotspots. So it's a portmanteau of education and roaming. So this network was, it was developed in Europe in around 2000, early 2000s, to facilitate students roaming from one university to other or from one country to other to access wireless network with ease. So this this global network is extended to lots of universities, colleges, hospitals, museums, airports, and many more research-oriented organizations. Eduroam provides secure and authenticated sessions. So login is encrypted as well as your communications. Each session is secure. So Eduroam is a standard, IETF standard RFC 7593. So why do we need Eduroam? So we're going to talk about next slide. So basically, there are two models, right? One is open model, where anyone can connect. And there is no security. This is fine if the wireless signal does not penetrate outside your boundaries or closed space. But problem with open and unauthenticated Wi-Fi is it's easy to misuse. Anyone can connect to misuse. So then there was WEP, which is pretty much outdated and nobody should be using WEP. So what WEP did was it had some rudimentary security on top of open wireless. So then came WPA and WPA2. So WPA2 is the actual standard. WPA was work in progress. So WPA2 PSK, PSK meaning pre-shared key. So everyone in the room, if you look at MPNOC2 wireless, we are using WPA2. So that means everyone using the same password. There's no, if I want to sneak your traffic, actually I can, because everyone is using the same password, so I can sneak your traffic and all. So you have to make sure whatever you are browsing, password you are typing is HTTPS. So WPA2 PSK does not provide authentication. Everyone is using the same wireless key, so it's not adequate for big applications or where you need user authentication. So there are basically two models of authenticated Wi-Fi. One is Wi-Fi, open Wi-Fi, where anyone can easily connect. But to get access to the network or other issues, there's a captive portal where you type your username and password. And if you're authenticated, you get access. Authenticated models are also prone to misuse. And we've been demonstrating this in many hotels and other places as proof of concept that you can just clone IP and MAC and you can use. So it's also pretty much easy to spoof. So WPA2 Enterprise. What WPA2 Enterprise does is it provides authentication, authorization, and accounting support. So who is using, what resource he or she can use, and how much he or she has used, these all can be tracked and managed. So for WPA2 Enterprise, your login transaction has to be encrypted, meaning I'll have a different session password, you'll have a different session password, and that password is not revealed to anyone else using the same wireless spectrum or same channel. So data login session, login is done separately, secure login, and also session. The session key is different between each user. Next one. So I pretty much talked some of these points. So accountability. What happens if someone misuses network? If someone does something wrong and you need to go back and find out who did that. So if you don't authenticate, everyone is in this room is using the same password. You can't really distinguish who is using. But in a wireless network where you can authorize and there's some accountability, what you can find out is, okay, this is the guy who was using this wireless at this date and time. So the problem is with authenticated Wi-Fi access, how do you manage access to guests? You can't really say, okay, I am not going to give access to guests. Then you have to provide wireless. So this is where Eduroam helps, because a student from one university comes to another one, and he's a guest there. He wants to access internet or some other resource that the university provides, but that user has to be authenticated and managed. Next slide. So how do you manage this? You can provide a temporary login password. You know, 1 hour valid username or password. You provide either your passport or some other form of ID to really authenticate that it's you. But the problem with these kind of things is it requires logistics to manage. You know, how do you keep the IDs? How do you keep track of who got what username and so on? So to ease all this, what Eduroam does is, Eduroam does not provide guest login for someone. There's no need to do that. If you have Eduroam deployed at your university or your institution, you come to a new institution and you see Eduroam SSID, chances are your phone or your laptop is already connected because it uses the same login, and that login information is validated through your university's radio server. Next slide, please. Next. So what Eduroam facilitates is, it has a centralized user database, and the organization that provides ID to you is called home institution. So what home institution does is it provides you ID. So ID could be something like username at tu.edu.np for Eduroam University, right? So that ID, it's stored at TU's servers, right? They provide, it's easy for TU to track. Okay, this is my student so-and-so, the student's ID is this, and so on. So you can use the same ID all over the world, wherever you see Eduroam SSID. So additionally, with central centralized user database and something like this, user can change their password whenever they want. You know, they can use self-service portal to do that. If someone provides you a guest login, he types it in his computer, someone is watching over his shoulder, and then he's really not comfortable, he wants to change it, it becomes difficult, right? But Eduroam allows you to do that. You can change your password whenever you feel you like, feel like changing it. So, login credentials. These Eduroam provided login credentials can actually also be used on wired network ports. It doesn't have to be only wireless. But our focus right now here is for securing wireless, so we are going to talk about only wireless. So, if someone with Eduroam login, he travels other places and gets connected to Eduroam SSID, it's called Eduroaming. So, yeah, Tassi just told me his Eduroam ID from Bhutan was, he came here, it was connected, his phone was connected already because he used his, once you get connected, so it's roaming is seamless, right? You just, your phone detects Eduroam SSID, you get connected. So he's Eduroaming now. So Eduroam provides managed and secure access. So user authentication is done, so who used what and when kind of things can be tracked. And it also provides for, it also allows you to do bandwidth management or QoS or other type of QoS. Or you can also provide, this is a teacher, this is a staff, this is a student, or even a student, you can differentiate and you can provide them different class of service. Next. So how Eduroam does all this? Many of you here are from ISVs and you'll probably understand the radius model or the radius technology. So what Eduroam does is there's a hierarchical layers of Eduroam servers, right? So each institution has its own radius server which provides login information to its users. So what they do is they peer with national radius service or national roaming operators servers. So these national roaming operators in turn they peer with European TLR or Asia Pacific TLR. So what Asia Pacific does is let me use the pointer. Point over here. Okay, so say for example we are in Nepal, right? So we fall under APAN, Asia Pacific Advanced Networks region. So Nepal Research and Education Network manages Eduroam peering for all of Nepal. So we have two sets of roaming national roaming operator roaming radio servers, right? So national radio servers. We have two sets of servers. And for all the participating member institutions, they peer with us. So say for example, prime.edu.np user wants to roam at tu.edu.np. So that sort of information, what happens is, prime doesn't need to know who handles radius for tu. They just forward it to NREN's radius servers. So what NREN does is, for all the peering members, it maintains who's server is responsible for these particular addresses, particular domain. And if these domains are not within Nepal, so what it does is it sends this to top level radius servers. So by this kind of hierarchy, all the requests can be achieved. Next. So I'd like you to be familiar with some of the terminologies. So institution is an identity provider who provides you login information, or a service provider who provides wireless access to where you can connect. So IDP is your university, student at tu.edu.np, also known as home institution. Service providers are all over the world. Eduroam has penetrated over 90 countries now. And if someone travels from home institution to other, it's a visiting institution. Next slide, please. So, roaming operators. So the top level radius is managed by GIANT. There are several servers in several regions and it's distributed so that it's resilient and load is also distributed across those top level servers. So TLRs peer with national roaming operators. So in our case, we are peering with two servers, one in Hong Kong and one in Australia. So roaming operators, I already went through some of these earlier. So for any domain ending in .np, those requests come to national roaming operator. So national roaming operator, what it does is it decides, okay, this is for so and so university, this is for so and so college or hospital or something, and it sends to the proper server. So, next slide, please. And in its infrastructure, we heavily use 802.1x. So 802.1x is a standard for port-based NAT. So it's an authentication mechanism where EAP is encapsulated over 802. So we also use PEAP, where it's extension of extensible authentication protocol, but it's protected, meaning certificates are used and encryption is done. So there will be lots of radius for authentication and accounting for all of these. Radius protocol is used. Next one. So to talk about the technology, if a user, supplicant is the client or user, that if it wants to connect to an AP, so he connects to the AP, but what Authenticator or AP does is it manages a secure connection, it manages EAP, and it gets the domain name from user. It doesn't get the whole username or the password from user. And using that information, it creates a tunnel to the actual authentication server or through various, you know, hierarchy of various servers and finds out the actual registry server who does the who handles the authentication. So authentication server, what it does is it stores its certificate. It uses a certificate to encrypt those data, and when that data is, you know, it's relayed back to the same method to the user. The user sends encrypted username and password, you know, authentication data to your authentication server or your home institution. So anyone in the middle will only see the name of the institution or the domain name, nothing more. So your password does not leave, or your password is not sent to any server in between. It's only sent to your home server. Initially, when it started, there were lots of compatibility issues, but we started Eduroam in Nepal last year, and so far we have not seen major incompatibility issues, except for some old OS which are already obsolete. Most of the modern OS, they support it pretty well, and most of the devices, they are compatible. So to recap, Eduroam is a federation of various servers. There's a hierarchy, there's TLR, there's NRO, and institutional radio servers. And Eduroam 2.1x standard is used. Next slide. Okay, to illustrate the security aspect of Eduroam, dot home is the home institution of the home country, or this is the country level radio server, right? National radio server. And this is the institution radio server. And there is TLR. And then this is visited country and another institution in a visited country. So if John wants to connect to the wireless, whatever he types, you know, the username and password, a tunnel is created and he's authenticated by his home institution, not by anyone in the middle, only by his home institution. Next slide. So because actual authentication information is inside an EAP tunnel, it's not revealed to anyone outside. So visiting institution will only know, okay, someone from dot home institution or institution dot home access my network. So if there is some problem, then he can So okay, we can skip this. I think we have already seen this. Next. Next. So what we can do is, if anyone wants to use you know, Eduroam roaming servers and all, NREN can help. This is not a commercial service, it's a free service, and NREN is here to help. You can allow people from visiting institutions to access your network, and in turn your user will get access to those institutions. And because of a global roaming agreement, it's free for everyone to use. Over 90 countries are connected, and it's growing every day. Next. So I'd like to mention that JAN, TNCC, and AARNET have supported us. Next slide. Okay. So we started last year, and by now we have around 7 institutions, and more are being connected every day. So next. So in this map, global map, Nepal is still missing, but we are actually active since 1 year, and because we have not submitted data, it's not present in Eduroam's website, but it's going to be fixed very soon. So next, if you have any questions, I think my time is up, but you can find me, you know, around, and we can discuss this. Thank you.